Penguin Random House Audio presents The Sea Beast Takes a Lover. Stories by Michael Andreasen. Read for you by Peter Altschuler, Michael Andreasen, Mark Bramhall, Cassandra Campbell, Michael Crouch, Robbie Damond, Kirby Hayborn, John H. Mayer, Arthur Morey, P.J. Auchlin, and Emily Rankin.
Our Fathers at Sea. The night before we load you into the crate and watch as the helicopter carries you off to the undisclosed location to drop you into the Atlantic Ocean, we eat dinner as a family. I roll your wheelchair to the head of the table, which has always been a little too small for five, so that it's clear to everyone who's being honored. I'd hoped to grill up a few of those ribeyes we've got in the garage freezer. It seemed the right occasion for it. But then Avery recalled how you'd always loved Rosemary's braised chicken, back when you were still on solid food. And so, in honor of you, even though you aren't eating, that's what we eat. We tried conversation for a little while. I think about going around the table and having everyone share their favorite memories with Grandpa, but I know, in order to do that, I'll need a really good memory, which I don't know if I have. As I try to come up with something, Ernest turns on the little TV we keep on the kitchen counter. I assume Rosemary will object, but she's busy checking the drip on your IV, and I'm busy remembering. So we let it go. As we eat, we watch Little Winston, part of the wholesome black-and-white hour of family programming that usually rounds out our dinner time. They're airing the Father's Day episode, which we've seen 100 times, but I think we all realize the importance of watching it again today, especially for the boys. Little Winston and his father, Big Al, sit on the front stoop of Big Al's Gas and Fix-It. They've just returned from watching Chester, Big Al's father and Little Winston's grandfather, get crated away. Their untouched glasses of lemonade sweat in the afternoon heat. Little Winston is folding and unfolding his sausagey fingers on the lap of his blue overalls, which he always does when he's upset, and Big Al is trying to console him. "It makes me scared," Little Winston says, tears poised to roll on the edges of his cheeks, "to think that one day they'll carry you off in one of those big crates, Big Al, that one day they'll drop you into the sea at the undisclosed location with a bunch of strangers, that I'll never see you again." "I know, son," Big Al says. His thick mechanic's arms normally crossed over his grimy blue work shirt in stoic disapproval of Little Winston's comic hijinks are now on the boy's shoulders, his rough, greasy hands straightening Winston's cowlicked hair in one of the series' rare moments of paternal tenderness. "When you get to be my age, you'll understand."
"I'm not going to be able to do it, Big Al," Little Winston sniffs. "I'm not going to know when or how."
"You will," Big Al assures him, his hand on the boy's back. "You will. Just follow your heart."
"I love you,"
Little Winston mutters. "Just follow your heart," says Big Al. "That's all I'm doing here."
"I love you, Big Al,"
Little Winston repeats. "I love you too, little buddy," says Big Al. "I love you too." Gertie Bills, the actor who played Little Winston, is an old man now and kind of a local celebrity. He retired to an enormous house up in the North Foothills and resurfaces from time to time for little events and fundraisers. I'm always surprised that people still come out to see him, since he never did another show after Little Winston. I remember once, not long after we crated Mom, we took you and the kids down to Ainsdale to watch him cut the ribbon on the new Pine Pleasant Mall. It was some crowd.
I ask Rosemary when she expects we'll read they've crated Gertie Bills. I even smirk a little, thinking this is a bit ironic, considering what we've just watched, and would have enjoyed a brief discussion about how the years catch up with all of us eventually, how we should take the time to savor its fleeting preciousness, etc. I think maybe this is something the boys ought to hear, that the time is right. But Rosemary's in no mood. This episode always makes her well up, and she's especially tearful tonight. She tells Avery to sit on her lap so that she can stroke his downy arm hair and make small popping kisses against his ear. Avery knows his mother needs him, and though he's old enough to sense that being babied is something he should resist, he doesn't. At the other end of the table, Ernest has gathered the bones from our plates and is attempting to reconstruct the entire chicken. When Rosemary's done mothering him, Avery asks if he can be excused from the table. "Kiss your grandfather goodnight," I say. "Gross," Ernest says, but Avery understands. He rounds the table to you, leans over the tray of your wheelchair, and kisses your cheek the way he kissed mine back in the days when he used to kiss me, as young boys sometimes do before their fathers put a stop to it. But it means something to me in this moment, watching my son give you, my father, this sincere kiss goodbye, which is why I think you, and everyone else, will forgive me when I say that he is the good one, and, of my two sons, the one I prefer. Then you start having one of your fits. It's a shame that Avery is so close, and he's just finished such a sweet thing, such a gentle act of affection, because your fits terrify him. Right away, his chin rumbles like a raisin to lock down incoming tears. I try to steady you so that Rosemary can secure the straps to your head and arms. Avery disappears upstairs to cry out of sight, no doubt assuming that his act of love has somehow caused your spasm. You pull against the straps like a weightlifter, drool snaking down your chin and little fingers. As I force your shoulders against the back of the chair, I can't help blaming you a little for ruining what had been a really beautiful moment, because a chance like that doesn't come again. And now Avery, who is already extremely sensitive, will always have this crappy memory attached to kissing his grandfather the night before he was crated. Hours later, while Rosemary readies the boys for bed, I put a couple of bottles of good beer in my coat and wheel you out onto the porch so that we can enjoy the lake at night. It's our lake, yours and mine, and now mine and my son's. For all the fighting, all the hurt feelings, the years of not talking even before you lost the ability to speak, we still end up here, you and I, looking at a lake full of stars. For some reason, one of the beers is much warmer than the other, almost room temperature. But rather than spoiling the moment by running back in for another, I suck it up and decide to just drink a warm beer. I put a straw in the colder one and set it on your tray, then lift my warm one and say, "Well, here's to you, Dad. We sure will miss you." I take a drink while you let the straw find your mouth. You manage a few sips and seem pleased with them. We look out on the lake, admiring the way its stillness makes everything around it seem not as quiet. I suddenly remember the memory I should have remembered at dinner, the day you taught me to catch tadpoles, which we used to keep in an old mason jar with a few inches of water. You showed me how controlling the water level prevented them from maturing into frogs, and how nice it was to keep tadpoles as they were, blindly swimming around until they died and we replaced them with new ones. It's a practice I've passed on to the boys who've lived their whole lives with jars of black blobs sitting on their windowsills, never imagining they should grow to be anything more than what they are. That night, I dreamed that Mom and I...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.